here with her. And let's start with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for Betty being here tonight. We thank you, Lord, that your spirit is upon her. We thank you, Father, that you will speak through her and bring your message. Father God, we thank you that we're here because Betty said yes many years ago. Mm-hmm. And so we today are greatly blessed by that. And we come in expectation and excitement for what you're going to do among us as we not only listen to you through Betty, but we listen to each other and share each other's lives tonight. Mm-hmm. We just give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so Betty's just going to stay here in the front row.
Well, I thought maybe I would.
You're going to come back
yeah.
here? Okay. So I'm going to be this here.
Considering 2 years ago I couldn't walk, I'm doing
it. Okay. So Laura, I think I'm the host right now, so I'm going to put you as a co-host. So
are you sure? I haven't been able to do everything.
Have you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But go for it.
Well, I'll just see who is.
And it's recording. And everything.
Mine says it's recording. Yes. But you can admit participants.
Mm-hmm.
That's the main thing.
That's full time. Yeah.
Okay, so I just want to keep an eye on that.
Yeah, I will keep my eye on that.
Okay, here's Mama Betty.
Maybe you could take this off. I don't know. I got. That'd be wrong.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Hey guys, we'll get this all sorted out here soon.
And so Betty, when you're talking to this, you're automatically talking to them.
Okay, I gotcha. Okay, that's good. I'm 86 years old. Today was the end of Yom Kippur, which is a time of fasting and prayer for the Jewish people all over the world. It's the day that the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies and the whole nation of Israel would be forgiven on that day. I've been to Israel 24 times. I've traveled in 55 countries, multiple times in many countries, like 7 times to Pakistan, 7 times to Nigeria, et cetera, et cetera. So it kind of gives you an idea that I travel a lot. And when I retired at 75, I never renewed my passport, so I would never be tempted to go out of the country again as long as I live. I'm done. So tonight, we're going to touch base with the Bible, with you, with what this ministry really is. And you're going to have some very significant training tonight that perhaps will change your life. I want to talk first of all. What is the hardest teaching Jesus ever gave?
Dying to self.
Love your neighbor.
Yeah.
You mean that creep? Oops. Well, I decided the hardest teaching that Jesus ever gave was found in Matthew 5, And if you have a Bible, you can open to it, and otherwise I'll just read it to you, so it doesn't matter. You have learned how it was said, you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. This was what the Jewish people had for in their religious system. The enemy was very dangerous. And, but I say this to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. And in this way, you will be sons of your Father in heaven, for he causes his sun to rise on bad men as well as good, and his rain to fall on honest men and dishonest alike. For if you love those who love you, what right have you to claim any credit? Even the tax collectors do as much, do they not? And if you save your greetings for your brothers, are you doing anything exceptional? Even the pagans do as much, do they not? You must therefore be perfect just as your heavenly Father is perfect. That means whole, W-H-O-L-E. It's not perfectionism, it's wholeness. You must be whole in your love. I decided this was the hardest scripture in the Bible, and I taught the Bible for now 50 years. I taught the whole Bible, 2-year course at Portland Community College in Belvedere, Crooked Rooms for 17 years. Taught every book in the Bible, even the Apocrypha. So I was very familiar with what was hard and what was difficult, but I decided this was it. This is the bottom line. And so I began to train in this. And one of the things that concerns me, I think we train in a lot of things, but I'm not sure we train in the Word. Does that make sense? And especially that we train hard in it. That we press ourselves to it deep and go all the way in and train in the Word of God. So I decided to train in this hard for 20 years. And that's my introduction to the book of Jonah. Jonah's a Jew, and the great enemy of the Jewish people, the enemy that was of great concern to him, was the Assyrian Empire. And the Assyrian Empire was one of the fiercest empires in the history of the world. It would be equivalent to the worst that we've had in my lifetime, when I was a child during World War II, and it would be even worse than that. And the Assyrians were the most powerful nation in the world at this time of Jonah. And I want to tell you a little bit about them. They had the most powerful and ruthless army in the world. They used the first iron of the ancient world in war. First time iron was ever used. Nothing could withstand the tough, sharp edges and points of Assyrian weapons. This caused a profound reaction in the ancient world, equivalent to our use of the atomic bomb in my lifetime. Their treatment of enemies as ruthless and terrible as any in history. King Ashurbanipal of Nimrud wrote between 1883 and 1859 BC when he lived, "I erected a pillar opposite his city gate." And he's talking about the people of Israel. "All the chiefs who had revolted I flayed. With their skins I covered the pillar. Some I walled up. Others were impaled to the stake. Still others I arranged around the pillar on stakes, Many within the borders I flayed, with their skins I covered the walls. Now, he's not doing this in Israel, but this is what he does. Takes them, and he does all of these things to their enemies. Do you think he loves his enemy? You need to know this, or you can't understand Jonah. Mm-hmm. If you don't understand this, you don't understand Jonah. You just think you do. They also developed a plan of transporting whole cities or tribes to remote places. Removal potential rebels from strongholds and settle them in their place, people who had only Assyrians to depend on. There was constant rebellion. The king had to lead all battles against rebellion, all military battles, no matter how hard. The kings had to fast wherever they were 5 days a month and perform certain ceremonies. So there was a religious component to it. But I just wanted you to really understand that when Jonah, when God said to Jonah, and now let's go to the book of Jonah, chapter 1, the word of Yahweh was addressed to Jonah, son of Amittai. Up, he said. I love that. I think that one of the biggest problems is no one's saying up to anybody anymore, except probably the top sergeant in the military. We'll say, would you mind getting up? God does not talk that way if he means it. You know, when he means something, he really, really, really means it. He might say, shut up to you. You say, well, God wouldn't talk that way. Do you know how much you talk? He might, if he needed to tell you something and you would never listen. You see my point. Mm-hmm. It isn't the way he wants to talk. Go to Nineveh, the great city, and inform them that their wickedness has become known to me. Jonah decided to run away from Yahweh and to go to Tarshish, which was towards Spain. So he's at the Mediterranean. Nineveh's this way. Tarshish is this way. He goes in the opposite direction. Now God arranges that there's such a big storm, and he's causing it because of his disobedience, that he tells the people on the boat to throw him overboard, and then they will be saved. They will live through the storm, and he's willing to die because, after all, he doesn't want to go to Nineveh, but he is willing to die, and he's willing to go in the drink. Have any of you ever been in the belly of the whale?
Yeah.
I think so. I think there are times when we are really, God is totally, so totally in control of your life, you can't wiggle anything. You can't make anything work for you. You can no longer maneuver yourself. He has taken charge, and he's got the final word where you are. And if any of you have been in that situation, yes, yes. And that's not a bad place to be. The word Jonah means dove. I thought that was very interesting. And it's the missionary book of the Old Testament. There is no book like this in the Old Testament. It is unique of all of them. So you can't say, well, this book is kind of like that, and that book is kind of like that, because none of them are like this at all. And so, even, you know, during Jesus' time, there was no New Testament. And I think that Christians think there was a New Testament. But there was not. There was only the Old Testament, or the Hebrew, I call it the Hebrew Bible. And so, the books that Jesus knew, the apostles knew, were the books in the Old Testament. Now, it's quite a remarkable thing, because Yom Kippur Will end tonight at 7 o'clock. And as it ends, in the afternoon of Yom Kippur, so we'll say this is late afternoon, they were required, the Jews were required to read the book of Jonah. At Yom Kippur, you do not eat or drink for 25 hours. And I have kept Yom Kippur every year for many, many years because I fast and pray for the Jewish people all over the world. It's something I do, something that's important to me. So I was in Israel for one of the Yom Kippurs, and I was staying with a Hebrew family. And in the afternoon, I said to my friend, I said, well, I think it's time for us to read the book of Jonah. I think he was surprised I knew that. And so we read it, and then I asked him about it. And he said, what do you see there? I love that. Instead of me being the teacher, Mr. Barrell was the teacher. What do you see there? And I understand that you have read the book of Jonah for this class. How many did their assignment? It's one of the shortest books of the Bible, so if you didn't, you're very naughty.
50 push-ups.
And I make them do them too.
That's right.
Anyway, I talked to Emmy Earnhardt, who lives in Florida, this week, and she called me. She's one of the writers in the You Speak Out book. And Emmy said, well, I finished the book and I just loved it. And I read the book of Jonah. If I'd have known it was so short, I would have done it a lot sooner. So for your reading, for your understanding of the Bible, Jonah is a very powerful experience. But we don't take it very seriously because, you know, it sounds like a wild tale to us. But it is something that, you know, the Jews said to Jesus, give us a sign, give us a sign. You know what Jesus said to them? The only sign I give you is the sign of Jonah. Now, everybody thought he was talking about the whale and the 3 days in the tomb and then gets out of the tomb. He was talking about this kind of love. He was talking about a love that transcends your life. In order to train in this ministry, you really have to know the difference between the love the world gives and the love that God gives and the exceptional power of that love. For example, you're going to have clients that you don't necessarily like. But early in the ministry, I saw I liked some more than I liked others. And I knew that was great sin. I identified this as a great sin. I could prefer no one. No one. The love could be consistent, it could be the same, but I could not give this one something special or be more glad to see this one than I was to see this one. If you're going to get serious about that, you need to make a list of all the people that you don't like very well and the people you do like very well, and you have to then regulate your love to be the same for both sides. That's a tough assignment, isn't it? Maybe you've got an aunt you never liked very well. Maybe you've got a friend that drives you crazy and you wish they could befriend you on Facebook or whatever. You know what I'm saying. We have these preferences. Now, when Jesus was teaching, he was so serious. He knew all of these things. He knew all of the games that were being played. He saw all the religious games. He saw the whole picture. And in the parable, in the story of the Good Samaritan, you know, the lawyer knew too. And he said, well, you know, I know. The lawyer said to Jesus, well, what can I do to be saved? And Jesus said, what do you read there? What do you read? What do you read here? you're supposed to love the Lord, you love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Now, if you want to train in another very hard development, I'm going to assign you a second training. Let's suppose that you chose the whole world to be your neighbor. And let's suppose that your mother was your neighbor, your father was your neighbor, your son was your neighbor, your daughter was your neighbor, the old lady down the street's your neighbor, Donald Trump is your neighbor, Joe Biden is your neighbor. I mean, I'm not trying to pick sides, so I'm just saying, let's suppose that you took Jesus seriously. Because I don't think we take him very seriously. Do you really think we take him seriously?
Not serious enough.
I don't know. I just, it made a big difference when I didn't think this one was more special than this one. And when I chose everyone in the world to pray for. I'm not saying I believe they're all going to be saved. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about love. Because without love, we are nothing at all.
Right.
The Bible is very clear. Without love, we are nothing at all. But love is so watered down because we, oh, I love you so much. Oh, I love you so much. Do we? So I took another assignment. I decided I would pray for Saddam Hussein, and I prayed for him every day for 25 years. I know of no other person in the world that took that case on for 25 years. I doubt if there was very many, because they pray. He was an enemy. You never pray for your enemies. You pray that God get them, finish them, destroy them, take them out. And I watched him being executed, and I was satisfied that my prayer had been worth my effort, and that prayer was important to me. I went to Iraq twice. The second time he was president of Iraq. So it wasn't just out of the blue that I did that, but that was a decision I made. What would it be like to seriously choose? We sing songs like, God to love the world, he gave his only son that died on Calvary's free tree, the sin to set us free. He loved what? The world? We're told to hate the world. He loved what? Without love, we're nothing at all. So during this time of training, you may be learning skills, you may be learning ideas, you may be learning things that will help you, but without love, you can't do it. It's too hard. You have no idea how hard it is. I used to meet with 8 to 10 clients a day. You have no idea how difficult it is. And the most important thing you do is to know them. To really know their whole story and to help them know it and retrieve the story. You know, we want to throw out the past and say, well, you're born again, so you don't have any past. Well, the past was part of the training to get you to where you are today. And you may slip and you may go back into those bad habits if you don't remember them and remember them that you have crossed over to a new life. But that life was part of the training to get you to the new life. I like to teach this way. If you have a jigsaw puzzle in a box and it has 5,000 pieces in it, and on the box it has the picture of what the picture will look like. When they come in, we have the outside picture of them, but we know nothing of any of those pieces and how all those pieces in their life fit together. So I emptied all the pieces out and turned them all over and studied all the pieces of people's lives. Boy, I know a lot about their lives. But they like that. They like somebody knowing them. Do we understand that Jesus knew the life of everyone he met with? No, we don't understand that. But let's take the case of the Samaritan woman. He knew all about her. We don't. So we have to turn that piece over and we have to understand it. And we have to understand how it fits together. And each person is on a struggle to salvation. Another thing that's really important that I don't think Christians get at all. And that is, we were all saved the same day. My salvation story, I could tell you, you know, here and here and here and here. But we were all saved the same day. We were saved the day of the crucifixion of Christ. Period. So no one could brag and say, listen to my story. My story is just fabulous. Because people love to give their testimony and they love to talk about themselves. But we're supposed to be talking about Christ. How many agree that it's kind of, you know what I'm saying? There's a kind of a self-centeredness in this, and we're really proud of our stories. You agree? How about you people that are listening? Do you agree? We were all saved the same day. And the salvation event occurred, I'll tell you exactly the moment it occurred, as Jesus died. The curtain in the temple was torn in two. It was ripped. It was torn. Now, the Holy of Holies was behind that curtain. And the law, the commandments, and the power of Judaism was behind that curtain. And at Yom Kippur, the high priest would go behind that curtain and take an unblemished animal and give that for the salvation of Israel. But that curtain was torn in two so that all of us could enter and receive the holiness of God, the Holy Spirit. It would be freely given to all. You ask and you shall receive. Is this too much for you? I want you to know how serious this visit is today. I will have come and I will have talked to you and I will have said, it's life and death that we love our neighbors, ourselves. And that's what your real training is, and that's the depth of your training, and that's the bottom line of your training. And that was the bottom line of Jonah's training, and he hated the training. Did he? Did he hate it?
Yep.
He didn't think God was fair at all. In fact, he did not understand that God who just said, that's it, done, finished. He didn't understand that at all. What kind of God would do that to these people that were destroying the Jewish people? Can you imagine the Jewish people being required to love Hitler? Or Himmler, or Heinrich, or whatever. You see what I'm saying? This is so preposterous. No other book even hits at it in the Old Testament. None other. Jesus, they say to Jesus, we want a sign. The only sign I give you is the sign of Jonah. This little four-chapter book, that's it. It has nothing else to say about it. Here's your sign. They try to make kind of a, you know, cover up for it and make it all sound something Jesus had in his mind. No, he had something greater in his mind than anyone knew. He had us in his mind. So how in the world would you train that your love would be consistent? For example, how many prefer your mother to your father? Raise your hand if you prefer your mother to your father. How many prefer your father to your mother? How many prefer neither one of them?
I love it.
All right. That would be a good example because they live inside of you. And there's no way to get rid of them. Your DNA is made up of everything they are, and they're inside of you, and you can't get them out. Now, if you love them both the same, and you choose them both, but my dad was a drug addict. He was a bank robber. That's one of my son-in-laws, by the way. One of my ex-son-in-laws. But I love him. And I mean him. You choose him. Because he's in you. And if you love him, forgiveness starts to go into his life. Now, one of the things the Lord taught me that is exceedingly important, how are you going to get your clients to forgive? How are you going to get them to forgive? What are you going to do? Speak out. What are you going to do? How are you going to get them to forgive? Yes.
Help them realize that failure to do so hurts them.
Okay.
And that it hinders God from forgiving them.
So anybody that speaks out there, make sure you speak loud. So
yeah, I have to.
Is that loud enough?
No, double it.
That you let them know that by not forgiving, they hurt themselves. They keep themselves in bondage.
Yes.
And that failing to forgive also hinders God's forgiveness to them. It's like taking poison and expecting somebody else to suffer for it.
Okay. This is a clean white sheet of paper. And this is how you forgive. My daughter was 15, maybe going on 16, I can't remember for sure. She was out till 3 o'clock in the morning with some boy. I was pacing the floor. I was so mad I wanted to murder her. You know how it is. How rebellious do you think she was? She's the one that married the alcoholic drug addict bank robber. Anyway, the Lord spoke to me the next morning and he said, I want you to give her a clean white sheet of paper every day. In other words, you are to keep no record of her wrongs. No, you're supposed to discipline her, supposed to punish her. You're supposed to train her. This was the training the Lord required. Absolute forgiveness. Did you know that forgiveness of sin is an absolute? If it isn't going to work. I want you to be shocked by that. It's an absolute. It's not compromised. It's not adjusted. You don't keep a record of wrongs. Now, I was a school teacher for 19 years. And they used to keep permanent records on all the students. And the teachers could make comments in those permanent records and were encouraged to every year. This student is almost impossible to teach, might be the comment one teacher would make. And then all the teachers would get out the permanent records and read the comments and they, oh my God, I got that student this year. Do you know, in Oregon at least, I don't know about the other states, but in Oregon, they made that against the law. No more criticism of a child follows them in school. Period. Clean white sheet of paper. So I gave my daughter Laura a clean white sheet of paper. She has a really profound relationship with Christ. I mean, literally, great, great, great faith. Was she good? Jesus said, why do you call me good? Only God is good. Just be a good little girl. Is he good? And mommy will be so proud and I'll be so proud of her. No, she wasn't good. I wasn't good. You weren't good. We aren't good. Because we compromise too often on many things. And we learn slowly. Now, many, many, many years passed, and about 12 years ago, maybe, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, I noticed you didn't give your oldest daughter a clean white sheet of paper. I had about six things in my mind, you know. Five, maybe. So I said, all right, Lord. Took me about a week to cancel. Gone, finished. Within 3 to 6 months, she was a different person. I never told my children I gave them a clean white sheet of paper. You know, most parents brag about what they do. I never told them at all. Let the proof be in the child themselves, not in my works of the flesh. So I never told her. I never told Laura. But I learned it. And you've got to give your clients a clean white sheet of paper every day, or you're going to take all that mess that they're telling you home, and you're going to get sick. Is that true?
Amen.
they could make you sick in an hour. Yeah. I mean, really, really tough things. I mean, I had a client come to my house. He was a man. And he said, I've committed a murder. And I said, well, tell me about it. He said, well, there was this bum, and we put him in the sawmill where I worked, and we sawed him up. That's a pretty heavy day. We just went to the sawmill, we just sawed him into pieces. So you're going to get sick if you don't know the absolute of forgiveness. How many would say that's probably true?
Yes.
And that absolute is so powerful, it destroys the record. Jesus said, whatever you unbind on earth will be unbound in heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. It's up to us. We're the ones who are going to decide. So always remember this, because it's a quick way to test your client, to test yourself, to test anyone. How many know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. I know you do, because we did test and we passed. Yes. But I don't think the church is teaching us these things, because the religious system does not know the absolute power of grace. They know about it, but they don't know from it. The absolute power of grace. The absolute power of forgiveness. The poor Catholics, they used to have indulgences. You'd buy indulgences, and or you'd confess your sins, and the priest say, "God, say so many Hail Marys and so many Our Fathers, and then you're forgiven." No, we're not even talking about having that. That client doesn't have to do one thing to be forgiven, except to begin to have it happen to them. My mother used to keep a record of my wrongs, and when she died, I found the records. I called Burness an old hag as a child. I mean, these are things, you know, as a child. But it doesn't matter. I mean, but that's how we are. We keep records. And right now, the whole earth is sick with opinions. How many would say that's probably true? Yeah. And the opinion is not based on Christ at all. It's based on the law. And the scripture says the law leads to sin, sickness, and death. One time, I had a client who was a serial rapist. And I was seeing my clients at home, and he would come, my husband would leave for work, and the serial rapist would come. And I had no one else in the house. I wasn't afraid. Because I understand the clean white sheet of paper, as probably none of you have ever even heard of. I understand it at a powerful level. So anyway, he was brought to me by the chaplain of Folsom Prison Penitentiary in California. And he said, he'll be a four, he's a three-time loser, he'll be a four-time loser if you can't touch it. If you can't find it and deal with it, we'll lose him. So I saw him for a year, a little over a year. He got better. But then one day I was in a bad mood. You ever get in a bad mood? And it was dinner time, my husband goes, and the doorbell rings, and he's at the door and he wants to see me. And I said, I don't care if you're Jesus Christ himself, I don't want to see you today. I walked back in the kitchen and I said, oh my God, what have I just done? I gave up every grace I had ever learned in my whole life in that moment. Well, I'll tell you what happened. A year passed. And he came to the door again. And I have never in my life had a more welcome guest in my house than that man. Because it meant I had learned my lesson and I was forgiven. A few months later, he said, I'd like to borrow $400. Now, I knew he didn't have any money. So I have to decide whether to go in the bedroom and write a check for $400 and give it to him. I have to make that decision. And I decided I would. Scripture says, you ask and you shall receive. Why would I withhold it? He wanted to buy a car. So I gave him the $400, and a month or two later, he came and he repaid $100. And I was, it was as if he repaid the whole debt, as far as I was concerned. It was such a miracle. But he gave me $100. And then he said to me, I'm going to go away and you'll never see me again. And in my mind, I said, who was that man? Was it the Lord testing me and training me and teaching me the word? Don't think you're going to learn the word in Bible classes. You're not going to learn it until you press into doing it. How many say that's true? It won't mean beans to you until you press in. And I'm pressing you hard into words that are not well known, are not well understood at all. So, you know, I went to Nineveh. You all know that. I think you've heard it. And I went to Iraq. It was hard to get into Iraq. And when I went into Iraq, I went with a British group.
Hey, Betty?
Yes?
I'm in the restroom. Can you pause for a moment, please?
Yes.
No, I'm joking. I'm joking.
Run! I love it. In the meantime, who has some comments?
I'm going to go get the sign-up sheet while he's going.
Yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
I can't, there's somebody in there.
Go to this one. I'm usually that way, so don't worry.
I don't know about you, but my faith is not always perfect.
No.
And if you don't have that forgiveness at that moment, what do you do? How do you, you know, I mean...
I never forget this as long as I live. This is my life. A blank sheet of paper with no words on it. Can you imagine? We say, well, do you know there are 800,000 words in the Bible? And we keep saying to people, just read the word. And then we don't even ask them if they know how to read. And it's been my experience that very few of them know how to read. I would say read a book and your client never reads the book. You didn't ask them if they knew how to read. Mm-hmm. It's serious. I used to have non-readers take Bible class. I had 50 students per class. I had three classes a week. So that was 150 students a week. And several of them didn't read. And I read the Bible to them. And you know what happened? Within 8 weeks, when they read their lessons at home, they heard me reading the Bible to them. They could hear me reading it to them. And they all learned to read. Is that not astonishing? I mean, if you learn nothing else in the whole universe but the clean white sheet of paper, you're not apt to forget it. Right? And it will help you in the most difficult, awful, nasty situations. I don't know what we should wait, but I am teasing. He has a clean white sheet of paper with him, which is really fun. There he is.
I'll rewind it when I get home.
No, you didn't miss anything important. So, I decided, my mother was with me and she said, we have to go to Iraq. She'd get these ideas and it just made me crazy. And I led a tour and the tour was just horrendous because we were held hostage and on the Jordanian-Israeli border and all sorts of things happened. A woman almost died on Mount Sinai and just a dozen things went wrong that were major. And then I sent the tour group home with my husband, and we had to go to Iraq, and I was so exhausted. And I got to Iraq, and one of the women that was with me on the tour was about 23 years old, and she had two little children at home, a three-year-old little boy and a little girl about 18 months. And the Lord told her to take this trip. Her mother-in-law said, absolutely not. Her husband said, absolutely not. And she said, I will not go unless they give me their blessing. Both of them completely, radically changed their mind, which was impossible. And she went. Now, when we were in the car and we were on the way, in Jordan, we were on the way to Petra. I was sitting next to her in the back of this car, back seat. There were three cars of us going to Petra. I won't explain why, but it was necessary. And she was struggling. Because the Lord spoke to her and said, would you be willing to give me your only son? And the car got dark, and the struggle was horrendous. And some people would say in the Christian world, well, that's just Satan talking. You know how the Christians are. They have all the answers, but they never ask the right question. And that's serious. That's a serious request, because there's the Lord speaking to this woman. And there have been one miracle after another miracle. She almost died on Mount Sinai. Her lungs collapsed. We laid hands on her and prayed. Her lungs filled with air. She made the climb up. That's 5 miles up and 5 miles down. No railings to hang on to. Stones, all different sizes. Over 1,800 steps besides all the long walk besides. Horrendous journey. So here I am in Baghdad. And there are about 16 people with me, and I'm with an archaeologist, expert from Cambridge University, Dr. Joan Otis, and she's taking us to all the sites in the country. And I'm studying the biblical archaeological sites, and I'm there 16 days. So I leave the hotel in Baghdad. I haven't seen Linnea for about 6 days. And I'm handed a letter at the hotel. And it's from America. It's from the man I asked to teach the Bible class while I was gone. And I didn't open it until I was on the train. And then I opened the letter, and her son died the second night she was home. They never found the cause of death. They sent the autopsy reports to many Canada, US, no cause of death, period. During the night, he called his mother in and said goodbye. He called his father in and said goodbye. And in the morning, he was passed. That story is in a book I wrote called Robbie's Prayer, Robbie's Final Prayer. It's well worth reading. So when I get to Nineveh, how do you think I feel? I'm exhausted. I'm broken. I have no requests before the Lord. I don't run around saying, oh, Lord, give me this ministry or give me that. I never do that. Never. And I'm standing up on top of those walls, and they're 12 kilometers long. And there are children up there playing. And the Lord speaks to me, and he stops my brain. He stops my brain, which had been as one who's dead, but you know, he interrupts my entire system and speaks and says, do you see these children? And I say, yes, Lord. And he said, well, here are the children. Where are the teachers? I want you to go home and quit your teaching job and teach nothing but my kingdom. I said, my husband will never agree. He said, I will take care of that. I said, all right, I will do it. So these are the walls of Nineveh, and you've seen the picture in the office, and somebody's probably told you the story, but I'm telling you this shocking story is shocking. So this ministry is based on a covenant. But the original person for this covenant was not Betty Mitchell, but Jonah. Jonah. Now, the children gathered, and I took a slide, and later, many years later, I blew up this picture, and I saw that they left a place for the teachers. But we said bombs, bombers, wars, constant battlefields, constant criticism. Is our love consistent? Is it enough? So when I came home, I told my husband what happened, but I didn't tell him. I didn't try to manipulate him, because it was up to God to change him. It was not up to me to do one thing. If he agreed, it had to be on his own life, in his own merit. He told me, you must do what the Lord has told you to do, and that was it. Many years later, I said, he was quite ill and having mental problems, and I said, maybe I should just quit and stay home and take care of you. He said, whatever I do to you, whatever I say to you, you are never to quit. So I'm under authority, heaven and my husband. Right. And that's all that's required.
So Betty, make sure that they can,
yes,
the voice is going to the speaker too.
I forgot you people. Here's the picture. Can you see it?
No, you need to hold it in front of you.
Okay, here.
And I did show this to you.
Right, but I'm just showing it again. I wanted to reinforce that and understand. The reason you're in this room is because that event happened. Okay, now, two or three days later, I'm at a place called Erbil, and Erbil is the longest continuously inhabited city in the world, 8,000 years, and this little girl standing on top of those 8,000 years, and there's 22 civilizations under her feet. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, when I look at the world, this is what I see. They're like this child. In all the debris of history, they no longer know what's important. This is who you will teach. So it's one-on-one. One client, one counselor. One counselor. You don't see us on TV, you don't see us, you know, with the big audiences. No, it's one-on-one. So that little girl comes into your room, might be a little boy, might be a man, might be somebody very elderly. But it's very, very, very important when they come into your room. It's really, really important. You are welcoming somebody. And you will change and they will change. And God will be present. You can trust that. You can trust it. You need to believe that he will be there. He will be present with you. He will touch you. There's only two people that can send a client to you. One is Satan and the other is Christ. Even the ones Satan sends, I recognize who had sent them. I didn't send them away. I just had to get him out of the way. So when you talk, you are talking to something inside of them that has never been able to hear anyone that talked to them. We talk about people every day. Amen? Is that true? But do we really talk to them? And do we really know them? And do we really hear them? There's no richer ministry in the whole world than this place. There is nothing richer. There's no greater call on the earth. So I come with the authority. And I say to you, this is sacred. This is holy. This is great opportunity. Even if you only see three people in your life, you will change those three lives and they will change yours. And they will enrich you and change you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Don't worry, I'm going to listen to you in a little while. So when I came home, it was very hard. Well, on the third thing that happened in Iraq, I went to Ur, where our father Abraham came from. And it was a tough trip down there. We went on the train. We rode most of the night on the train. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, they got us out of the train, sat us in a room. My mother didn't know where she was or who she was. She had just kind of gone sliding into Alzheimer's. And I didn't know whether I could get her back. I mean, just incredible. But we went out on the Tell at Ur. Tell is a place where the archaeological site is. And it is the original Ur. And I'm walking, and I'm walking, and I'm walking. And the Lord speaks to me a third and final time. And he said, every thought in your brain is negative and judgmental. And I said, I agree. I've been listening. Nonstop, you know, nonstop. How many could relate to that? He said, I want you to speak your thought to me, and I will tell you mine, and I will change your mind. Now, that's it. I didn't try it while I was gone because I had to get home and I had to get my mother home and I had to deal with the realities where I was. But when I got home, I sat down in a chair and I said, but God, my brain goes 100 miles an hour and it goes 10 thoughts at a time, like 10 thoughts going through my brain at the same time, 100 miles an hour. How do I slow it down to get one thought? That's how. I mean, why choose somebody so disability with so much disability as I had? But I want you to have some hope that you're teachable and that your disabilities can be relieved. So I sat down in the chair and I found out I could change the speed of the thoughts from 100 to 10 miles an hour. And that if I just sat there and slowed them down, said slower, go slower, slower, I could get one thought. And I said, Lord, this is what I think. And I said, what do you think? And he never agreed with me once. Never, never. Do you know how many opinionated people have been your teachers? And how dangerous that could be? And it's dangerous to your clients. It's very dangerous to your clients. Can you imagine being wrong every thought and being corrected? So it took 5 years. In the meantime, I was seeing clients, but during that 5 years, I was submitting. Not, obviously, I didn't go around doing this all day long. I'd be cross-eyed. But I did it several times a day, and I did it seriously. And then one day I said, Lord, I have no more thoughts. Only yours. Because when he replaced it, he kept it there. He kept the new thought there. It didn't have to be memorized. It was there permanently. So, you know, then I began to have dreams. And in the dreams, he was cleaning out the unconscious mind. I got the conscious mind cleared out, but the unconscious mind still had stuff to get rid of. If you have bad dreams, that's a great news. Because it's surfacing evil and it's coming out of you. It's called deliverance. And in the scripture, Jesus says that in the prayer, deliver us from evil. Well, how do you think God does it until you go to sleep? He doesn't have any access to you.
That's true.
So I'm serious. You know, I've told people this over and over again. Many years passed and my husband's mental illness increased and increased. And finally, he finally agreed to go to a counselor. He went to 5 counselors. They couldn't touch it. They didn't know what to do with him. He said, I want you to be my counselor. I said, you will hate my guts. I'm going to correct every word coming out of your mouth. He said, I will submit. He submitted for 3 years and the mental illness left. I want you to look at these issues. These are big, big, big issues. Big issues. Now, one of the things that happened when I got home, I said, Lord, why me? I mean, what the heck do I have to do with all of this? I'm just me, you know, nothing. He said, it has nothing to do with you. It has to do with Jonah. So if you turn to chapter 4 in the book of Jonah, Jonah was very indignant at this. He fell into a rage because, well, if you look a little ahead, men and beasts, herds and flocks are to taste nothing. They fasted and prayed for 3 days without food and water. All are to put on sackcloth and ashes and call upon the name of God with all their might and renounce their evil behavior and the wicked things he has done. Can you imagine the Assyrians doing that and that the king asks them to do that? I don't think the Jewish people had much faith that this really happened because they had a lot of faith about how evil Assyria was. But this was going on. So Jonah fell in a rage. Have you ever fallen in a rage?
Never.
Have you ever fallen in a rage? Come on.
Yeah.
I get tempted every day, don't you? One more robo call, I'm going to kill you. For 4 months, the bank didn't send my bank statements. For 4 months, I called the headquarters in Ohio. This is nothing. We should be in a rage about much more important things if we want to rage. I'm just showing how weak we can be. And then smile and try to be nice. He prayed to Yahweh and said, Yahweh, is this not just as I said would happen when I was still at home? That is why I went and fled to Tarshish. I knew that you were a God of tenderness and compassion, slow to anger, rich in graciousness, relenting from evil. So now, Yahweh, please take away my life, for I might as well be dead as to go on living. How many of you have ever thought that sometimes? I hope not today. The day is not over, however. Yahweh replied, are you right to be angry? Oh, gosh, I hate that question. Are you right to be angry? By the way, when you talk to God, he wants to say something, but we don't let him. Jonah then went out of the city and sat down to the east of the city, and there he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade to see what would happen to the city. Then Yahweh God arranged that a castor oil plant should grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head and soothe his ill humor. And Jonah was delighted with the castor oil plant. How many of you have been really delighted after a really hard time? You got this big breakthrough. Yeah. But at dawn the next day, God arranged that a worm should attack the castor oil plant and it withered. Next, when the sun rose, God arranged that there should be a scorching east wind. The sun beat down so hard on Jonah's head, and he was overcome and begged for death, saying, I might as well be dead as to go on living. God said to Jonah, are you right to be angry about the castor oil plant? He replied, I have every right to be angry to the point of death. Yahweh replied, you are only, and here's the important part. Right now, this is what you have to learn, and you have to learn it forever. This is a lesson that Jonah had to learn. You are only upset about a castor oil plant which cost you no labor and which you did not make grow, which sprouted in a night and has perished in a night. And I am I not to feel sorry for Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, say nothing of all the animals? End of book. What's missing? What's missing in this book? Something that's very important is missing.
Jonah's repentance.
Say it again.
Jonah's repentance.
Yeah, Jonah did not answer the question, and a couple of thousand years later, I showed up and took the question, and I bring it to you tonight. I'm just to deliver the question. We could love our enemies. Yeah, I love my enemies, no problem. No, I won't have them to dinner, and I wouldn't have them marry my daughter, but I could love them. You know how it goes. You want to bargain. So this was the question, and Jonah failed to keep the covenant that Jesus came to deliver to someone else, because Jonah did not learn the lesson. I'm going to read it one more time. Am I not to feel sorry for Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, to say nothing of all of the animals? So as you're training, as you're preparing yourself, as you're thinking about it, as you're changing, as you're allowing yourselves to be wrong 100% of the time, because there is a greater idea than we have in our minds, because our minds are limited, finite, kind of, you know, what's convenient. I used to be a substitute teacher, and I was a really great substitute teacher. I loved it. I was going to do it the rest of my life. I loved doing that. And when I got a call, no matter how inconvenient it was, I always went. I always went. One time I had my hair in curlers. I just washed it. I took all the curlers out. It was a snowy day. I had to drive up a mountain. I had no lunch. I didn't know they didn't have a cafeteria. You went. You did it. So it's learning to be on call 24/7. They say, well, that's not good for us. That isn't good. No, it isn't necessarily good for you, but God's on call 24/7. Do you want him to take time off? Would you like him to just shut down a little bit and be on call when he's convenient to hear you? And say, call me back later, I'm too busy today. Right. I don't want to hear one more prayer request out of you. You're driving me crazy. Do you see my point?
Yeah.
I'll tell you a story. A woman called me. I didn't even know who it was. She called me for 6 months at 3:00 in the morning, breathed into the phone, and after a while hung up. I answered every single time. She never stopped. At the end of 6 months, she spoke to me. And we had a conversation. Again, if you want to be tested, you're going to be. But if you don't want to be, you're going to be. So adjust. Okay. So you can see that the story of Jonah is very, 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 very important, because this question is why this call has come. It's why it has come upon this group of people. We're not the only Samaritans in the world. And by the way, a Samaritan is not a cult or a sect. It's Christians in action. And sometimes non-Christians in action. Because I think great deeds sometimes are done by people There was a man named Eddie in Pakistan. He and his wife would go out and pick up dead bodies. And they lived in a little two-room house, and they had a table. And they'd bring that dead body lying on the ground into their house and wash that body and bury that body and take care of that body. He was a Muslim, but he wasn't. He was a Samaritan. He founded the whole ambulance system for the whole country and changed Pakistan from being terribly non-compassionate to more compassionate. So it's somebody who knows the difference between a God of love and a God of regulations. How many understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
Because we have lots of a God of regulations. Lots and lots of a God of regulations. And it's the God of regulations that crucified Jesus, because he healed people on the Sabbath. And that wasn't allowed. The God of regulations.
Not,
I have a question to ask you, because one day a woman called me. And it was she wanted to come and see me with her daughter at 10 o'clock on a Saturday night. This is many years ago. And I said, all right. She brought her daughter. Her daughter was 9 months pregnant and 10 years old. These are the things God sees that we don't want to see. We don't want to know. We don't know what to do. But a Samaritan will see it. They will see it. Okay. I'd like you to talk a little bit and take turns and say anything that comes to mind. I know that some of the things I say sound very shocking at first, but they're the cause for our concern. If you look around the world, there's a lot of shocking things going on in this world. And we really don't know what to do. But one-on-one, we could do something. Does that make sense?
Yes.
You can't change 1,000 people, but you can change one. Mm-hmm. And you can relate. And it might be somebody you've been neglecting or not even remembering or not even thinking about them. I'll tell you one last story before I let you talk, so you can think while I'm telling the story. I went to the Holy Land, and my dad was dying, and I knew he was possibly going to die while I was gone, so I had a final meeting with him in the nursing home. He'd been paralyzed on one side and had a stroke 6 months earlier. And I said, Daddy, I'm going to leave. Would you give me your blessing? And I gave him my blessing, and I said, I probably won't be here if you die. And so we did this, and it was fine with him. My mother had Alzheimer's, and by this time very serious. And my husband was here. And the nursing home called my husband and said, you need to bring his wife. He's dying. So my husband got out of bed and took my mother over and dropped her off and went home and went back to bed. He never had known that I found out about it, because I don't go after people. But I found out about it, and it just made me angry. So after 3 or 4 years of that anger, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, at least he was here. You were in the Holy Land. Thank you, God. I got it. But we do get angry. We do get frustrated. We do get hurt. We do the wrong thing sometimes. It was very interesting, because I knew exactly the minute my father died. I was in the Jordan River baptizing people, and I knew he was dying. All of a sudden, I knew what was going on. And about 3 days later, I was in Tel Aviv in a hotel, and the group had left, and I was staying on in Israel for a few days. I knew the instant he died, the instant And I called home and they said, your dad has just died. And I said, I know. I'll be home in about 2 weeks. We'll have the funeral then. It's okay. So I'm just, you know, it's a very inconvenient ministry. But it's the inconvenience that many times there are very few people that are willing to be inconvenienced.
Yes.
Have you ever tried to get people to be inconvenienced? One Christmas, a woman and her son had nothing in the refrigerator and no presents in the house. And she called and I knew who she was. And my husband said, well, I'm going to go check. That's Jerry. He's going to go check. So he opened her refrigerator and went in the house. He said, no, there's nothing there. So I called. The Lord said, I said, the Lord, what shall I do? And he said, well, call this group of people. So I called all these people. One, my mother said I could give a head of lettuce. And some of the people said, well, I could give something next week. Mm-hmm. And one family, it was Christmas Eve, about 7 o'clock at night, and they were at the grocery store buying all of their food for Christmas because they had limited money till that time. They took everything they bought to her.
Yeah.
One, the Lord wanted me to see what the problem is. He was teaching me. Here is what I see. People are not understanding the power of my inconvenience in their life.
Amen. Amen. Amen to that.
How many would say that that's probably true?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, let's have them talk, Cindy, and I'll let you field that and we'll discuss.
So, why don't you put this computer on the in there?
Okay, so in GSM tradition, what was important to you this evening and what Betty shared?
Forgiveness.
And so if you want to, I ask you to all speak up very loud or even come forward so that you're closer to the speaker.
Maybe this chair could be the talk chair. So when you're going to answer, so they can see you, we could even move it a little closer.
And those of you online,
same thing.
Yeah, come sit in this chair.
Yeah, come sit in the chair.
Why not?
You'll need to unmute yourselves to talk. And this is Debbie Hesse.
I'm Debbie.
That's in the chair right now.
For me, the most powerful thing that you said tonight was to quiet your mind and let the Lord speak to you instead of all this gibberish that we go through every single day. Even in asking for answers from him, we don't shut up enough to even listen to his answer.
Mm-hmm.
That, for me, was a huge takeaway tonight. And I'm going to practice that.
And working with that, because you're going to teach many of these things, you're going to teach your clients.
Mm-hmm.
You're not just the only one going to learn this. You're going to teach it. You're going to make a difference in many people's lives. Trust me, there's not many teachers that are simple enough that the crowd can get it. We've got very learned teachers out there teaching these very learned things. But do we get it? The clean white sheet of paper is a lot easier than talking about the absolutes of forgiveness and giving 15 scriptures for it. So it's reaching the people. It's speaking to the simple in language they can understand. Pardon?
That is a mark of a great teacher. Taking something complicated and making it
simple.
Meeting people where they're at, like Jesus did.
Right.
Okay, we had Rich online want to say something.
Okay, Rich, go for it. Where are you?
Hey, I never heard you before, but I really appreciate, you're one of the few people that I've actually heard that truly says to, you know, love your enemies. I think that people feel that if they go out and reach out to the center next door who has a lifestyle they think is not appropriate, that they are that they are condoning the lifestyle by reaching out to those people. And that is so opposite to what Jesus was. And I think for me, I look at a lot of the evangelical community and I wish more would reach out without the fear of thinking they're endorsing a certain thing that people are doing. And I think that's a huge thing in America, why we're so divided and so screwed up, is because we simply just don't love our enemy.
Absolutely not.
And that includes the world. I mean, when's the last time I ever went to a prayer service for the family of ISIS? Never. And that's what Jesus commands us to do. And I really appreciate what you said. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, it's Susanna. I think what really impacted me is that visual of the blank sheet. Forgiveness is total. It's not just, everything except for, even memories, but not just for other people, but for myself, because I can't have a blank sheet for somebody else if I'm holding stuff.
You're right.
Unforgiveness for myself. So I really love that visual. I think that's going to be really helpful to have one of those up.
And you can see even a child can understand a clean white sheet of paper.
Yes.
And tell the children that they used to keep permanent records in the schools and they don't ever do it again because they learned that destroyed the child's life.
Right, right. Because I think too, it will help me to press in to how God sees me and accept that identity and also look for at the people I'm seeing them through his eyes. And rewriting the script, so to speak, you know, even filling it up with his identity.
Yes.
That makes sense. Anyway, that's what I was thinking.
Thank you, Susanna. Bolar, unmute yourself.
Really great lesson I learned today. We always have opportunities to change someone's life by talking to them, by loving them. Then I learned that let's change our minds. Then let's train yourself just loving enemies, your enemies. It's really a good lesson for me also. New thing I learned. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bolor. Grace.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Cindy Womack teacher. And I'm so happy to learn today. And I would like to say, Luke 23 and 34, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. You know, God say that. That's why I always keep mind this forgive someone, you know, because God forgive me. Then I learned today in Jonas chapter 4 and 4. I know that you are gracious, God, and merciful, slow to anger and abounding and steadfast love and relenting from disaster. This class is my first class. I never learned English language, you know. Then I went to 8 years in Mongolian church, speaking Mongolian, reading Mongolian, talking Mongolian language, you know. Then I'm learning today a lot of things. that's why I really want to speak and, you know, talk with you guys. And thank you so much for teaching and listening, you know. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for being online.
Thank you.
Let's see, Veronica, did you have your hand up?
I have something. I did. Hi, everyone.
Hello.
I think one of the things that I took away tonight is, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. One of the things that I took away tonight, when Betty was talking about that you're not going to know if the person is coming to you from God or Satan, and to know the difference, and when you see that it's Satan telling him to get out of the way. Because I think it's easy when people come to you not to think of how they got to you. And is it really that you have to look at that and see and how to deal with those situations? So I think for me, that was helpful hearing that, because it's not always going to be God who's sending these people looking for help. And you've got to be able to pay attention enough to know so that you can help them. And so that was really, that really touched me hearing that.
Okay. Thank you, Veronica.
I have a story to tell about that. I had a client that a pastor sent to me.
I'd love to hear it.
And the pastor, the church did not know what to do with her. And in studying her life, she had been raised since she was 3 years old to be a high priestess to a satanic cult. And by the time she was six, she had to murder her dog. And by the time she was 10, she had a baby by her father and had to kill the baby, and suffered tremendous things that, I mean, who could heal from all these things? It took me 17 years to work with her for her to be okay and normal. And during that process, in the early stages, only Satan, the first 6 months, only Satan talked to me. But the key was never to talk to Satan. I would talk only to the three-year-old. Because before she was three, she was not there. And I had to find the three-year-old and engage the three-year-old and teach the three-year-old to trust me. And never, ever, ever argue or talk with Satan. Satan would say, "She's mine." And I, you know, the temptation is to say, no, no, I'm not converting Satan. I'm concerned for the three-year-old child to have a normal life. I took her to the Holy Land twice during that time. And it's incredible, you know, what we went through to get her well. But the point is, if we engage Satan, he will keep us busy 24/7. Mm-hmm. You kind of know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Satan kind of gets you engaged and goes, la, 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 la. Okay.
Deanna Wallace has had her hand up.
Deanna Wallace?
I got a lot. I have many notes here. And I'm really blown away that for the first time since I started reading the Bible in 1970, I finally have some insight to the book of Jonah. So thank you for that, Betty. But also I wanted to say that I really was impressed by what you said about the jigsaw puzzle. It really helped me to understand better how to help people. And I mean, I already know that I need to talk to them, but to really know them and to really hear them and turn over all the pieces like in the jigsaw puzzle. That's very helpful to me.
Very, very good. Soon some of them will fit together, but we tend to try to go too fast.
Yeah.
But the information, I study the grandparents, I study the parents, I study the siblings, I study their friends, I study their school experiences, I study their sex life. I mean, it's just at their relationship with God, their understanding that they might have and what they don't have. You have to know a lot in order to know them.
Yes.
And then what you're really doing is you're talking not just about information. You're talking to the inside of a person.
Yes.
Good.
I never see it as, oh, I have all this information. No, it has nothing to do with information. And I don't take it home and worry about it. But you have no idea how much that influences the generations. The generations know. They come, they talk. It's very, very important.
Thank you, Betty.
That's such an important point, is that when you touch one person,
you're touching many.
You're touching every generation after them. And every person that they touch today. You know, we all have our own circles of influence, whether it's our direct families, our churches, our friends, our enemies, you know. You have an influence on everybody. In fact, there were several of us who were talking the other day, Betty, that said it would blow our minds if we could see how many people that are currently alive, even, that have been affected because Betty said yes.
Yeah, because it's a ripple effect. It goes out.
Yeah. It's like
Christ, you know, Christ is still alive because the generations are still learning from him.
Mm-hmm.
He's still our teacher. He is our teacher.
Yeah. Rob.
I was at a party about 35 years ago. And it was a clean party. Good bunch of people sitting around watching this little movie called The Gods Must Be Crazy. cute little movie. But there's this one scene where this lady is at this diner. And she's at this counter. And the lady next to her looks at her and goes, "Does the noise in my head bother you?" Everybody laughed, except me. Because I knew exactly what she meant.
Absolutely.
I knew exactly what she was talking about. And you talked about it tonight, too. And I really felt good because I'm not alone.
No, no.
I mean, this was
a tough case.
Yeah. Two real quick things I wanted to ask you, okay? First off, I need to make amends because the legal aspect of what you were talking about, how it gets you sick, I need to make amends. I sent an email to you because of the reading material.
Mm-hmm.
I was concerned about that because of the Kabbalah.
Right.
And I have a problem with the mysticism mm-hmm. and the reincarnation and all that kind of stuff. And in a Christian environment, that made me concerned. So what? Get over it. Get over myself, right? But I was legalistic about it. And as soon as you spoke about that, I went, and I was
gone. Clean white sheet of paper.
It pierced my heart, though, and it was great. So my amends. Forgive me. Okay.
Accepted. Totally.
Thank you. The second thing, and this is what I want to talk about, because you say that the book just ends with no question, no repentance or anything like that, right? Didn't Jonah write Jonah?
I don't know.
Most scholars believe that, though, right?
I don't know.
Okay. If Jonah wrote Jonah, wouldn't the way that he wrote Jonah show a repentant heart in the way that he understood who he was?
Probably. It's very interesting because he's one of the great prophets of the Iraqi people.
Really?
And really seriously. I mean, he had more influence on Iraq than we could possibly know.
Because the way I had studied it and how I've been taught it,
right.
Okay, it left me with the feeling that that was a man who understood how repentant he needed to be,
right,
for him to be able to write about how cruel he really was.
Right.
You know, Moses said he was the most humble man on earth. I don't know, man. Jonah pretty much got that. You know, he understood who he was. So I just wondered what was your opinion?
I don't know. The Lord told me it was for Jonah that I was just
I was just carrying on the work that had begun at Nova.
This whole Bible teaching was the best Bible teaching I've ever had.
Project.
Look, 53 years of life, best Bible teaching I ever had. Thank you.
Yes.
The part about it's not convenient. It's never convenient.
Never.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
The more things go wrong, the more my spirit says, I really need to meet with this person. And that just happened to me last week. I've been trying to meet with a girl I mentor that's like a daughter to me. And the minute we actually, like 3 weeks go by, she had to cancel, I had to cancel. It finally works out. And she's in her car, goes to start her car, and her battery's dead. Mm-hmm. I'm like, of course, you know. So then I'm in my car, and so she expects that we would reschedule. I'm like, no, I'll just come over. And then she said, well, AAA's on the way. That's fine. I'll wait till they're done, and then we'll go. And then she had to drive the car. So, I mean, it's just one thing. I said. Then we finally get to dinner, and she's like, oh, I have a story for you. I'm like, of course you do, because everything went wrong trying to get to your story. And I left her a card that she read after we met. And she was in tears the next day and thanking God. This is a girl who totally turned her back on God for the people that come into her life that aren't family, that are like family, and I'm like a mother.
That's right.
It's never
no, just say, I'm just your neighbor and I'm a Samaritan. Would you like to be one too?
Can I share it from my chair here?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can you pull your mask on far enough so we can make sure and hear your voice?
I just want to share, it's kind of a personal experience. I had a granddaughter that went through a very, very difficult situation with the state. They considered a medical kidnapping. She has a metabolic condition, and the state took custody of her, put her in foster care for 6 months because she has a weight issue. But anyway, God used it to get her into the Christian school my daughter wanted to send her, a full ride, everything turned around. Anyhow, she's been released, the case was closed. Let me tell you, I spent many a day praying for the enemy,
right?
And they all turned to her side.
Mm-hmm.
She came to me one night and needed to talk. And she finally opened up to me because I shared with her the fact that 40 years ago when I got saved, they locked me up for my faith and what I went through. And I said, look at Grandma, she's not crying. I said, God's taken all the pain away. She was then able to talk about the fact they'd taken her to this place called Robinswood before they could find her a place to live. Anyways, I've just been praying and praying and praying for her. She came to me last night and she said, Grandma, I have a new favorite scripture. Mm-hmm. I said, oh, what is it? She said, Hebrews 11:5. She says, I feel it here.
Wow. That's fantastic.
And I'm like, I just looked at her and I said, the word says, open the eyes of my heart. It's through your heart that you seek.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. Yeah.
Powerful story. So this is Lynette that's coming forward.
Thank you for bringing up inconvenience.
Uh-huh.
I had to wait 19 years for my daughter. We had lice one time, and it was bad. If any of you have ever had it, you know what it is. And the Lord spoke to me during that situation that if I didn't have my daughter, I probably wouldn't have been inconvenienced with lice. And would I ever trade the value of my daughter and my life for the inconvenience of having to deal with a consequence? Not ever. And I really have come to learn that often when we're inconvenienced are the opportunities for some of the richest moments in our life, for us to touch people and to be changed. And the Lord's been changing me in terms, He just has opened up for me to help with some homeless people. And I just last night, you know, was just grieved because some of these people are believers. Mm-hmm. Where are we?
Huh?
Where are we?
Don't even ask.
You know,
a long way from the assignment. The Christian world is a long way, many of them, from the real assignment, because we're not given it. It's not clarified. I don't blame the Christians. It's just not clear. But how many would say that it often is not very clear what our assignment is?
Right. So I met this man, his name was Daniel, and he was at a little, partly what I've been doing is picking up food that are in some local food pantries. It's just people who I'm sure are not Christian people that are just caring about people out there, but not everybody can get to them. So I will take stuff too where I know some of them are. And I ran into him, there wasn't much there, but I had some stuff in my car. So it's dark, he's pedaled up on his bike. And I just asked, I said, are you looking for food? And I offered some things, and he had some needs because an apple wasn't a good thing because of his teeth and stuff, and had a banana, but I'm trying to be honoring to them as people.
Yes.
And what they prefer or what they would like. Not just take this food and be grateful that you have something. You know, just honoring them as people who need, and everybody needs food. And it grieved me last night to, realize that he said, he believes God. He knows he asked me to pray for his hip, which I did, and all of this. But here he clearly, oh, Lord, help the church. Help me, help the rest of us. We are supposed to, especially for the household of faith and the Christian people, be taking care of his brothers, still reaching out, yes, but we're not even taking care of those that are part of the body of Christ. And it just grieves me. And I'm like, embrace inconvenience, let the Holy Spirit lead us to do what we can do.
In the years ahead, when you are doing more of this kind of work, a word you'll keep in the back of your mind is this: one of those inconveniences she talked about years ago. You know what I'm saying? It'll come back to you. You'll recognize it, because many things are inconvenient. One time I was leading a tour to the Middle East, and I stopped in London. The plane stopped in London, and I had a couple in London who needed counseling. And so I said, "Well, you go through passport control, and we'll meet." And so we met, and we sat on the stairway in the airport and had a counseling session. So it's inconvenience is a very important part of the ministry, because it's not, I've heard 1,000 reasons why people couldn't do things. Mm-hmm. And I can't think of one that necessarily should throw out the assignment. But we're trained. That's just not convenient today. Could I do it next week? We think that way because we're allowed to think that way. I called a friend of mine it's a long story, I won't go into the story, but I called her and I said, I want to see you tomorrow. She's an employee at the state hospital in Salem. She's got bucco things on her left. She called in sick and said, I'm coming. She came. But she's been a Samaritan for many, many, many years. And oh my goodness, the work that woman has done is unbelievable. For example, she went downtown Beaver in Portland and took an absolute drunk off a park bench and took him home. I mean, advanced alcoholism to the point of death. And dried him out at her house. And he would have epileptic seizures. I mean, he had multiple problems. And Clayton became part of Good Samaritan for a couple of years. And eventually then he went back downtown and died 4 days later. But the point is, we reconciled it with the whole family. Good Samaritan paid for his funeral. Didn't ask the family to do it. They all came to the funeral. We buried him at a decent place not cremation. We treated him like he was an important family member, because he was.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And on my house is a big sign about this big on the front of the house. It says Mitchell, and Clayton made that sign. He would sell these signs. That's how he made enough money to survive. I mean, so anyway, it's exceedingly important. You don't have to do the work here. You just have to do the work. Mm-hmm. You'll be led where you're to do it.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to hear from Hannah Solly. Can she hear me?
Hannah, can you hear us?
Hannah!
Yes, I can. Yes, Mama, I can hear you.
Yes, Mama, I can hear you. Well, I want to hear you.
Thank you so much for the class. I really liked the white sheet, introducing the white sheet, and I would love to know more about how to use it and how to do it.
Well, I guess you have to figure that out. And Hannah, I know how brilliant you are, and I know that you've been assigned to disciple 12 people, and I've known you've been assigned to reread the books I wrote. So I already know the training Osborne is requiring at this time, so you're all busted. I'm going to check on all of you.
Thank you, Mama. Thank you so much. I will.
Hold everybody's feet to the fire. It's really, really, really important we take it seriously.
Yes. Yes, Mom. Yes, Mom.
And for those of you that don't know, Hannah is in Uganda.
She's amazing.
She's one of our leaders there. Sabrina.
Thank you for the teaching tonight, Betty. And I just want to say I'm married to someone who, some of you know this, Betty definitely knows this. I married someone a couple years ago that grew up in the ministry from the time he was very young. He's 53 now. We got married a couple years ago. And tonight's teaching really hit home because I know how important, me personally, the effects of the white sheet of paper. I was taught the white sheet of paper when I was being naughty, and my husband would say, I love you. I'm giving you a white sheet of paper. And I asked him about the white sheet of paper. And he wasn't saying it in a pompous way. It was in obedience. And he told me the story of the white sheet of paper. The part about always being available when it's inconvenient. About a week ago, I called Betty in the middle of the day. I think it was actually at night. It was late. And she answered. And she was available right away. My husband has called her in our years, that short amount of time we've been together, but every single time he has called her, even when she was going in to speak on Easter service, she took his phone call. She has taken his phone call every single time. And the power of that consistent love and showing that he's important has transformed even me. It has effect on me, seeing that her consistent love for him, always being available when it wasn't convenient. And even their entire family during this time is affected by Mark's sister has stage 4 cancer. And this week I was praying about how I could be of service. And frankly, God has had all of this beautiful stuff happening around me, and I've been able to see the Holy Spirit working in inconvenient times, in tough times. And yeah, I'm so grateful for the teaching tonight, and I've seen it work in my own life through what you've taught for 50 years through my husband. Thank you. Thanks, Betty.
Good to see you tonight, Sabrina.
Thank you, Betty.
I think this lady clear back there needs to come up and sit in this chair.
Oh, okay.
It's called the hot seat.
No, I've been avoiding the hot seat. I've been a Jonah. I've met you in 2012, and I still remember what you said to me. It didn't make any sense to me at that time, but.
All right, 10 years later, she still remembers what I said to her. Eight years later. And this is important, because if they don't remember what you said, you didn't say it strong enough.
That's true.
You have to speak as one who has authority, and most people are just so relational, and they're listening, and da-da-da-da-da, and pretty soon they don't have any authority.
Yeah. And you didn't say a lot. You just said two sentences, but it was very firm, and it was very strong, and I remember that. And so tonight, there's many things that you said too, that the white sheet, I was actually thinking of someone that I know that I thought, wow, she's done so many things wrong. And so it just hit me so strong tonight that I need to give her a white sheet.
Mm-hmm. So you could see the action can take place. Mm-hmm. But we're not taught in ways that it's simple enough that we can do it. If we say you need to forgive her, is that going to make it possible? Because you don't know where to start.
That's right.
But a white sheet says that you've got no record at all.
That's right.
Doesn't matter what she did.
It's actually so creative.
This is God's idea.
That's right. So thank you. Another thing that just stole your mind, I'm still working on that too. Quiets my mind.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Be still and know that I am God.
Easy to say.
Can you imagine being wrong with every thought going through your mind? Yes. That's called being teachable.
Or married.
And your wife's probably right.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Where do you live?
Important.
Okay.
Yes.
Hey. And what's your name again?
Irma. And I'm from South Africa, and you taught me to look at cosmos, and we are still friends, still today.
Do you see? It's good.
I've
been to South Africa 3 times.
She got up at 4 a.m. last Saturday to have a satellite meeting with South Africa.
I think it's fantastic.
There you go.
Okay. Gabriel. Gabriel Stroop.
Yes.
I don't see your picture.
Oh, it's coming. Let me see. My video's being weird.
Turn on the light.
Oh, it is a light. Who knew? I got to have a light on. Oh my.
Yeah. So what did you learn tonight?
Hello, Betty.
I don't think you were on time for class, were you?
I thought your teaching was very good tonight. Just 6 months ago, you called me, you said, welcome home, Jonah.
And now you know why I said that.
Now I know why you said that.
That's a great honor to be called Jonah.
as far as your, the idea of the white sheet of paper, there's so many people in my life that, I hate the idea of giving a white sheet of paper to.
Praise the Lord! You just got an A tonight. I love that honesty.
Well, if I lie, I know you're going to call me out anyway. So I think that was a very profound thought. And teaching, and a very truthfully convicting that it's like, you know, and, you know, just the way God works, you know, the first people he brings to mind is everybody you don't want to give a white sheet of paper to.
Uh-huh. So, like, well, about this. You're young, you have a long list now.
Oh, yes. I make a new one daily. So anyway, I thought that was very profound and a very big challenge to anybody who's not challenged by that. Probably needs to rewatch the video again when it's reposted on YouTube. And if they still don't understand it, they need to watch it again.
And if they still don't understand it, they need a personal appointment with me.
And sit down wherever she tells you to, and, you know, it may end up with a spanking or whatever, but, you know.
You never know. You need
to save your soul, so.
Well, Gabriel, you would have loved it. A week ago last Sunday, I was preaching, and a young man in the church that is the son of a pastor who usually is here but wasn't here, he was late for church, and we needed him to do some things, and he was late. And I said, well, I was a teacher, and I always gave 50 push-ups. He dropped to the floor and did 35 push-ups in church during the service.
Yep.
He's willing to be inconvenienced.
Instantly.
Instant obedience. And you know what happened last week? It's a great story. I was watching Ruth Bader Ginsburg's funeral was last week, and she was the first woman ever to be honored by the whole nation in the Capitol. And her personal trainer, you know, and you would appreciate this, Sabrina, you would appreciate her personal trainer, her physical trainer, came to honor her at the service. And when he stood by the casket, he dropped to the floor and did push-ups. The same week I gave that student push-ups.
Yep.
Isn't that funny?
It's hilarious.
It was a divine event.
I could see Mark doing that.
Yes.
So, Kirk Lee, we haven't heard anything from you. What do you need to say? You have to unmute yourself. Okay.
Okay, I'm kind of sorry. I like the white sheet of paper to forgive, to forget. I catch myself sometimes when I tell someone I forgive them that I remind them what they do to me or something, like I really didn't forget.
Yeah, we want to tell them. We want to tell them and have them crawl a little bit.
And, like she said, there's people out there that are pretty hard to forget, not forgive, but forget or give them that white sheet of paper. And on the inconvenience, when God first called me, I thought my calling is everything, because I had a pretty easy life, Christian life, and things pretty much were going my way. I was skiing all the time, and then God calls me, and things kind of get tough and inconvenient in some ways. And I'm like, are you sure you want me, Lord? And questioning Him and all that, but I'm still on the same path. And I always thought it was just going to be easy, my calling, that everything was going to go my way. God's going to take care of it all. It hasn't really been that easy. And I'm having to, you know, the spiritual warfares and putting the armor of God on. And it's not always easy, but I'm still at it because God wants me to. And he leads me, and I trust him because I pray every day and listen to him, and I know I'm going the right way. I'm in this class right now, so things are leading to the way he wants me to go. So thank you. And Betty, you taught me a lot today, especially Jonah. It was a struggle to speak.
That story of Jonah is really important. You can see. Nothing like it in the Old Testament.
Yeah.
Jesus said, the only sign I give you is the sign of Jonah.
Well, you were a blessing to me. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Kurt. It was good to hear your voice.
I'm finished. Thank you.
I'm looking at this one back here. You.
Let's see. You know, I gotta say, I don't think I can add anything that hasn't already been said about forgiveness or what's the other one? There's two topics I just out of the top of my mind. But I do have a question for you, Betty.
All right,
and it's been burning in the back of my mind. And it's about that little girl, that poor little girl that was involved in that satanic cult. And you touched me with that story. And I know it's not the assignment here. How did you get through, and how did you get through to that little girl? Because you said the demon was talking.
Satan himself was talking.
So how did you actually communicate with the little girl? How did you get her to come out?
First of all, even for me to touch her, she would freak out.
Okay.
She didn't sit down in my office for 6 months. She paced. I saw her every week, and for 6 months, she paced the floor, and Satan came out of her mouth full time. But I knew what I was after, and I was after that child. Past the time of the satanic training, that child disappeared. But that child was still in her.
How did you get through?
I kept talking to that child, and eventually that child began to respond. It took a long time. So it was about patience, and it's about the consistency. What is it you're after? Mm-hmm. What is it you're looking for? I'm looking for the faith of that little child.
Thank you.
I'm looking for her. And when she found out that I meant it, and that I would not give up. I mean, year after year after year. She was vomiting blood all the time. There was just all sorts of stuff going on. Just they would make her drink blood. I mean, she was just, it was a disaster. But I think that the church, and we also, because I'm the church too, we want quick results.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They consider deliverance prayer, 3 hours, you're done, goodbye. Mm-hmm. No development.
Right. Yeah.
No development. What deliverance is going to last? None. I mean zero.
Thank you.
Yes.
And you will see.
That story shed some light on something that happened to me. I was helping a friend at Rolling Hills put out the desserts for Celebrate Recovery. And this one night, everybody in the church got in a stir that there was a demon-possessed man in the church.
Oh, I know.
Anyways, so he comes in and he comes over to the table where me and two other women are standing. And begins to address me, and the demons are speaking about Jesus in the on the 40 days. And I just kept saying that conversation's in the book of Deuteronomy. And he said to me, where? I said, read the book of Deuteronomy.
I love it.
And pretty soon the Lord told me, go to the kitchen and get him a cookie. And I went and picked up a cookie and I prayed over it. And I took and I gave it to him. I said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that flows from the mouth of God, which was part of that conversation. Mm-hmm. And he picked up that cookie, took that cookie in his hand and went walking out of there. She gave me a cookie. She gave me a cookie. Mm-hmm. And then this one guy that plays in the band, he said, Susan, I'm glad you were here. I knew you'd know what to do.
I love it.
Anyways, and somebody else said, why didn't you cast that demon out?
Oh,
I said, no. I said, they can make things seven times worse.
Casting demons out.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The
scripture says, deliver us from evil. Deliver the person from evil. That's the Lord's Prayer, right?
That's an entirely different thing than delivering the demon from the person.
Yeah. And he prays in John 17 to keep us from the evil one.
But Susan's right. You do what God says to do.
Correct. And a cookie not, a child understands.
Right. Yes.
Not, you know, and she's she didn't get to finish it. You want to finish, Susan?
Yeah, go ahead.
About if you tried to do that, what could happen?
You can make it seven times worse. It tells you in scripture. If you clean a house and they don't receive, that the demons go through every places and come.
They will keep you so entertained, it'll be unbelievable.
Tortured.
You know what I love about that story, Susan, is that you were obedient to the Lord to go get a cookie, and you touched the little child inside that man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
You touched the person instead of the demon.
Right. Yeah.
That was
he
awesome.
He was like, she gave me a cookie.
Mm-hmm.
She gave me a cookie. And James Autry, which you know, he's a friend of mine. When I shared the story with him, he said, I believe God's going to do more there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Do we have anybody else online that wants to share? We have about 5 more minutes is all.
Yes. What's your name?
Oh, Saru.
Yes. I've learned 3 things, but most of the things that I've learned all has been already mentioned by others, but the most profound thing that I've learned is, of course, the white sheet, and it's totally new for me. And the second one is that everyone knows about that love is the most important thing, but I like the Betty's statement saying, without love, we are nothing. Mm-hmm. So that's what I knew, but it sounds, yeah, we need to have a love that would be powerful in any cases, in any inconvenient, you know, situations, you know, to show it to everyone. And also with regard to the love, also we know we need to love our enemies as ourselves. And then I like the example that Betty, you mentioned about, ask Jewish to love the Hitler.
That's right.
Yeah, so that's what the problem.
And I'm not saying that cheaply, because I've been to Auschwitz twice in Poland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've been to Hiroshima twice. I've been to Hanoi and North Vietnam. So I'm not asking this with a foolishness about it. It's a serious thing.
Yeah, and then now I'm thinking, how are we going to love? And then you said it is, you have no idea how it is to love your enemy, you know, and how it will be difficult. So I'm glad that I'm in this class, and I'm in the way or the process of learning how to love your enemy.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Am I going to get that story from you?
Me?
You know who I'm talking to.
Yes, I think so.
Yes, you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I did have a few things that I picked up. I think my mom growing up in this, raised us in this whole Samaritan family, and it was such a big honor to do that. But I really, what you were saying about, you know, loving your neighbor is not just loving the easy people, it's the loving the unlovable, loving the people that aren't the people that you would normally love. And I feel like once you start loving those people, they feel value through God, and they their whole demeanor starts to change. And it's such a beautiful gift to be able to see that process and to see the light kind of spark back in them from just their past and all the things. And I think that the white paper is such a beautiful visual to give to people, that God does that, but we need to show them how that works.
It does. Yes.
And then also the fact that when you're loving your neighbor and you're praying for those that persecute you, sometimes we're the answer to that, praying for those who persecute you. And God is so funny how, you know, when you're praying about somebody that's just a thorn in your side, that you end up being that answer to prayer, that God shows you a different side to them or puts that forgiveness in your heart so you can show love to them. And it's such a surprise in this daily world that it's very interesting how that really comes about as being something really special, and great friendships can form from that.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So those are the few things that I took away. I got like pages and notes as well, but I might have to watch it again just to
I watched that written story in my house this week.
Yeah.
Lori, don't run away from it. It's important.
I know it is. I do.
Edition of the book. The book is done. I have the book. You can come and get it. But the second edition of the book I'm putting out, I would like that story, your story in it, from your family.
Okay. I think that's important.
Thank you. Sabrina?
Was it Sabrina?
She raised her hand.
There is a transcription program that's free that I've used from Amazon Web Services. That is extraordinary. So Lori, if you want to audible your story and you can get my email somehow, or I can tell you how to plug it in, it'll take it and put it into words. Just as a side note, my husband did that. So that helped.
And he wrote a 10-page story, and it's one of the best stories in the book.
Story.
Yes. And he used audible and transcription. So free.
Right.
Okay, was there anybody?
This one has not spoken.
Oh my.
She gets put on the spot.
Hi, my name is Trish. I'm Margaret's daughter, in case anybody doesn't know.
And if you don't know who Margaret is, that's Maggie.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Actually, I have had a heart for the Lord for a long time, and it was called the ministry a long time ago. I have yet to finish fulfilling. God has. I've always had a fear with some of it and not liking to be front and center. Thank you. And so he'll use who's willing, and no one ever wanted to scrub the toilet, so I did. So that's what I've done. But my husband and I got married, and I was previously married. And he was raised by a Marine Southern Baptist preacher. Me, quite different, but he married me with my three children, and yes, I was married before, so he married me with the kids, and it all went really well, and the kids, you know, teenagers are teenagers, they do what they do, and they did some things that I don't think really could forgive, and so our marriage went on, and things have been where they've been, and we went through a series of things, and I'm real familiar with the white sheet theory. It was something I always practiced. Every day is a new day. You get up every day, and with my health conditions and things, the joy of the Lord, I could do anything. I could take care of people. I'm up at 4 a.m. I mean, I could run. And then one day I just got upset, and I just said, not this time. God, I'm just not forgiving it this time. Not this time. This is the 100th time. No way, no how. And I went away with it, and I thought later on that I had done it. But in looking and listening to what you said, God brought it straight flat up to the surface. And I'm like, oh, hell yeah. The practitioner of the white sheet is in trouble. Well, when you were talking about marriage, I always had influence in our home and in our marriage. And when he did forgive the kids, my influence started going down. And instead of realizing that I hadn't forgiven him, I blamed him for it. And yeah, so there has been this contention, and it's put a halt to it. And the funniest thing is our daughter, she came home last year. She ended up being a heroin addict, and she came home and ended up pregnant. She came home pregnant, and we've had her sober. Her son's at our house as well, and Brooklyn was born in December, and I cut the umbilical cord. I've been there for all of my children's births, and she's at home, and we had decided that this time when she came home, I told my husband, I said, if you ever want to have me to yourself, you ever want, I don't want any more sleepless nights, and if what you really want is to have an empty nest. We didn't do anything wrong the time she came home before, but there's a difference between what's right and what's best and honoring the process. And I love my husband dearly, but he is not the most patient individual. He's been waiting a long time to have his wife and his house, and so it has been quite a tumultuous.
My husband lost his castle entirely.
Mm-hmm.
The minister started in our house and ran in our house for 5 years, and he'd come home and there'd be three people on the davenport waiting to see me.
Yeah, more. I've inconvenience doesn't bother me.
No, I know, but it bothers them.
Yeah, and so, but I'm learning that in my unforgiveness, it's making it where we're having the imbalance.
Right.
And
so
that if I, and since he just happens to be in the pickup sitting outside, my goal is the minute I get outside is to ask him to forgive me and call this good. Mm-hmm. Know in that practice that I would have known. But some things we have very far buried, let me tell you. And that just happened to be it.
Okay. I want to hear from him. Ronnie. And then we'll quit.
I would also say that what I've learned is always that without God we're nothing, and a white sheet of paper. And I like the verse, James verse 19, that says that we should all be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to
anger.
And I think it is not very hard. I mean, it's very hard for people. When you experience it, you feel like it's impossible. Being someone who from Rwanda, who has grew up in that place where the genocide happened,
mm-hmm.
It's very hard for practicing the white sheet of paper,
mm-hmm.
but I have seen it in many people, and it has helped me to not to use it in my
That's
life.
Good.
Yeah.
That's
so
very
it was
good.
A really good reminder.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've all seen tonight that what is the most simple is the most profound.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even have to read the white sheet of paper.
Yeah.
There's no lesson here to read. Okay. That's it.
You want to close us in prayer?
What did you learn tonight?
What did I learn tonight?
I think we should put
all of it. Again. All of it again. Yeah. Another white sheet of paper. Well, shoot.
I thought you were done with all of
that.
I think every time I hear you teach on Jonah, though, I get something deeper and more profound
yes.
out of it. And
the question was left for the history of the world to look at.
Mm-hmm. And the piece for me was, I think, finally getting it when Jesus said, I leave you nothing
but the sign
of Jonah. And I'm sure I've heard you teach on that before, tonight I got it.
Well, the apostles always thought it was about him going into the fish, he's going into the tomb, and he's raised from the dead. And they had that whole theory in the Bible, but they didn't ask Jesus what it was about. they came up with that one to avoid the assignment.
I think what you shared with us makes so much more sense.
Yes. He knew what he was talking about.
Yeah.
He knew about the question.
Couldn't it be both? Pardon? Couldn't it be both?
Yes, but I think we conveniently use the other to avoid the conscience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's our conscience that's being spoken to.
Mm-hmm.
Can we really do it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can we love our neighbor?
Yes, we can, because
mm-hmm.
God asked us to.
Anyway, thank you for having me tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rob, why
why don't you close us in prayer?
Sure. Holy, praise your name, Lord. It's all worship, all praise, all glory. It's in you that we are here. We are here in agreement in your name. So I thank you, Holy Spirit, for being around us. I thank you for piercing our hearts with your message. I thank you for your truth setting us free even more. I thank you for what we're learning here. I thank you in advance for what this lesson will do for us and through us for others.
Mm-hmm.
We thank you, Lord, for this ministry. We thank you for our desire and our heart and our passion to want to learn more, that we come here on our own volition, for our desire to know you more, so that we can help others more. Thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for Betty and for her gift. We thank you for the ministry that you've given her so that she can pass it on to us, so that we can pass it on to others. Because, like she said, this is a ministry that will outlive all of us, Lord, and this is to go on. So thank you, Lord. We just thank you. We praise your name. We give you all the glory, and we thank you for this time. Now, I ask and I thank you in advance for taking us home safely.
Mm-hmm.
Getting us home safely, and through this week, practicing these principles and what we do. So that those that see us go, you got something different. Let us be that light in this darkness, Lord, and bring us back to the next appointed time so we can get closer to you, to know you more, so we can help others more. In your precious, powerful name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.